Let's look at compound verbs, which are section 88 in Hansen and Quinn's Greek and Intensive course, and that's on pages 270 to 271. In Greek, it's really pretty simple. Prefixes can be added to verbs to enhance or change the meaning of the root verb. We do this in English too. So you know what throw means, but if you say throw out, that means something a little bit different. And if you say throw up, that means something different again. So in those two instances, we simply add a preposition separately from the verb to change the meaning, even though the root idea is a little bit the same. Same, with wind, where we can wind up. English also does what Greek does, which is actually to combine the two pieces into one word. So we can have put, but we can also make that input. We can have mine, and then it means something different when you combine it with the preposition under. So undermine is a compound English verb that takes a different meaning from the main verb. In Greek, you have learned a whole bunch of prepositions already. This is most of the ones you've already learned, and all of these will get used quite frequently in compound Greek verbs. All you have to do to use them as prefixes is take off those accents and sometimes change the letter a little bit and add a hyphen, and you'll get the form that Hansen and Quinn is going to give you when they reintroduce each of these prepositions in vocabulary as prefixes for compound verbs. So ace will mean in or into, ek or x will mean out of course, and we can see, for instance, the example of ekpempo, send out. Sometimes a prefix will slightly change its form in compounds because of the linguistic comfort level of one consonant before another. So you'll definitely see M instead of N when the meaning is the same in or into. Para and prepositions that end in a vowel will also have a form that doesn't have that vowel. Same with apa. And sometimes if the consonant that is then at the end of the combination form is susceptible to contagion from a rough breathing, if it's combined with a verb that starts with a rough breathing, that form will change as well. We don't have an example of that now, but we do have an example of a verb with apa, and apopempo means, of course, send away. And I wanted to start showing you one of the strangenesses of compound verbs in Greek, which is why it even merits its own video. So with ekpempo and ekpempso, it's pretty simple what you do. You're simply adding the preposition to the forms that you already know. In the third principal part, however, you get exepempsa. And notice what happens there is that the augment goes between the prefix and the stem of the verb. And in this instance with ek, it changes which consonant ends the prefix itself. So you have to pay attention to both things. When we move on to the fourth principal part, it goes back to a pi at the beginning of the stem, and so we go back to ek. And ek pepemai in the fifth principal part, but you see again in the sixth principal part how the augment goes between the prefix and the stem of the verb, and you get ex epempthane. Similar things are going to happen with apopempo. So second principal part, no big deal, but apepempsa shows you two things. Again, that the augment goes between the prefix and the stem, and that here, with a prefix that in its preposition form has a vowel at the end, loses that vowel before another vowel. It gets that omicron back in the fourth principal part and the fifth principal part. But again, in the sixth principal part, we're going to have the augment between the prefix and the stem, and the Omicron is going to go away. So here, have a look at the prefix forms of all of these prepositions that you've already had. You will be reintroduced to them in Hansen and Quinn in your vocabulary lists. Many of them will mean exactly what they've meant as prepositions when they're in combination with verb forms. Some of them will have other meanings or other implications in compound verbs. There are a couple other things we have to learn about compound verbs. The first is a big rule about accents, which is that they cannot go back onto the prefix. So accents on compound verbs recede only as far as the augment or the stem of the uncompounded verb form. So that was really not a big deal. And the verbs I've shown you so far, so here's ekpempo again. And because the stem verb is long enough, the accent doesn't want to go back onto the prefix. But say we have a verb like ap ago, I lead away. In the first three principal parts, you're just fine. Ap ago, ap axo, and ap egagon. Again, the receding accent doesn't want to go onto the prefix. But when you get to the fourth principal part, ap ega, and the fifth principal part, ap egmai, you have to give the accent the way you see here. It wants to recede as back as far as it can go. And here we've got three syllables, but because that first syllable, that third to last syllable, happens to be a prefix, Attic Greek doesn't want that accent to be on the up. So it stays on the second to last syllable, and it's then following the circumflex rule, which says that if the accent has to be on the second to last syllable, and the second to last syllable is long, and the last syllable is short, then the accent's going to be a circumflex. And that's what you have here. And the sixth principal part, the recessive rules for accent keep it away from the prefix anyway, and you're just fine. So that's one of the rules for compound verbs that you have to know. And you should remember that, too, when you do the imperfect of ap ago or verbs like it, where, again, in some of the forms, you're going to have to keep the accent on the second to last syllable. One last thing to tell you about compound verbs. Sometimes Greek is quite happy to have the compounded preposition repeated in the rest of the sentence. So here we have ap egon apa tes polios tus stratiotas. I led the soldiers from the city. The repetition of the idea of apa isn't emphatic. It's completely normal, and you don't have to translate the idea twice. So those are the basic things you need to know about compound verbs. The big challenge is when you see a verb that you're unfamiliar with, you may not immediately see what the first principal part form is because of the changes that both the prefix and the verb go through in the different principal parts. And you have to be aware of what those changes can be and that the augment is going to appear in the middle of the verb and not necessarily at the beginning. So good luck and practice a lot and enjoy all the new meanings you get from Greek compound verbs.